Hey guys, it's Danny. Happy New Year. Please excuse my voice. The holidays left me with a few health issues here and there, especially when it comes to my voice, but this will not stop me from making a video today. It is the very first video from 2020, and you know what? We're gonna talk about birds. No, just kidding. We're gonna talk about Phalaenopsis, but I couldn't pass this opportunity to film Maya because she's so puffy. Joey's puffy and cute as well, but she's on egg duty, so she's not very, very friendly these days. Getting back to our orchids, as I was saying, today we shall discuss about Phalaenopsis, specifically how to obtain multiple flower spikes on your orchid, at least two flower spikes. And this is a question that I saw in the comment section a little while back, and I thought it would be a great idea to talk about it in a separate video. And if you know me, you know that I like to give many, many, many details in my videos. I like to start with the beginning, give a lot of details and explanations for why I'm saying what I'm saying. So, to get it over with, for those of you who are in a hurry, the best way to get multiple flower spikes on your orchid is to care for them properly. Now, if you know how to do that, you should have no issue in obtaining multiple flower spikes on most of your Phalaenopsis orchids, especially the ones that you purchase in flower shops, since they are hybrids which can do that. But if you are interested in the details, I will actually start with the very beginning, with the types of orchids that can actually produce multiple spikes. So first off, you should know that not all Phalaenopsis orchids can actually produce multiple flower spikes easily. There are many species which most of the times will actually produce only one flower spike per season. And mainly I refer here to the summer blooming species such as the Phalaenopsis bellina, Violacea, Gigantea, and their primary hybrids, or at least their close hybrids. These particular Phalaenopsis belong to the subgroup Polychilus. I'll link it down below to an article from the American Orchid Society, which talks a little bit more about the different groups of Phalaenopsis orchids. So in my experience with these types of orchids and their close hybrids, it's really not easy to obtain multiple spikes per one season. Since they are sequential bloomers, they do hang on to their flower spikes for a few years. So in the end, you will have a few flower spikes, but that depends on many things, one of them being the age of the orchid. A young orchid is less prone to having multiple flower spikes than an older orchid, but these things grow very, very slow. So if you purchased a near seedling size orchid, you do have quite a few years ahead of you before you can expect multiple spikes. But I digress, as always, back to our story. In my opinion, these types of orchids are not the ones to have if you're looking for multiple flower spikes. The ones you want are the typical, no ID in many cases, star-bought Phalaenopsis. Whether they are big or medium-sized phals or mini Phalaenopsis, with the star-bought Phalaenopsis, which are very complex hybrids, you have the most chances to obtain at least two flower spikes pretty easy. But of course, even within these hybrids, you will find some individuals are just more prone to double flower spike production than others. There will be some which will refuse, no matter what, to produce multiple spikes, and that pretty much boils down to genetics. The end goal with Phalaenopsis is not to have them produce multiple spikes, but just to bloom the way you want them to bloom. It's not even a standard of, oh, you grew this orchid correctly. We cannot really say that as long as genetics are heavily involved in this, and we cannot control genetics. With that said though, if you do want to try and promote double spikes on your orchids, I will give you a few tips or a few bits of information that, if you're a beginner, you might not have, and hopefully they will help you out. But the first thing you should know is that not all orchids will produce double spikes or multiple spikes. So now let's continue with a physical criteria your orchids absolutely must meet in order to produce those spikes. One thing I always mention in my How to Rebloom Phalaenopsis Orchids types of videos, which by the way, you'll have one in the description of this video if you're interested, is that flower spikes are produced in special locations on the stem of the orchid. You might have already noticed that they tend to sprout from the sides of the orchid, if we consider this the face or the back of the orchid. Furthermore, in 90% of the cases, spikes will sprout two leaves down on one side of the orchid as we count them from the crown downwards. So in my example, we have one, two leaves and a flower spike. And on this side, same story, one, two leaves and a flower spike. This is the usual and typical location where all flower spikes sprout from. So logically, if there is no available space for a flower spike to be produced, then it will not. The space actually needs to mature enough to form that growth bud, which will sprout a flower spike. Further up, the orchid is way too young and the location is not ready yet. And in practice, this means that if your orchid did not grow enough during its growing season, then it will not be able to physically produce multiple spikes. So here's an example where I can show you what I mean. This is a mini Phalaenopsis with a growing flower spike, and the spike emerges from two leaves down. On the other side, if we count two leaves down, we can see that we have already a remains of a dried flower spike. This means that that location simply cannot physically produce another flower spike because it's already occupied, it already bloomed, and Phalaenopsis don't produce multiple spikes from the same location. A little side note, it might appear that in very rare cases they do, but most of the times it happens that the flower spike simply travels under the leaves. That's a whole different story, but just wanted to make it clear now because I know it can happen and I'll show you an example. So the first rule that your orchid needs to meet is to have an available space on both of its sides to be able to produce spikes. And this available space happens if the orchid grows. The more leaves grow, the more spaces available on the stem form. So if we want multiple spikes from our orchid, we need to let it grow. We need to provide that vegetative growth period, which usually happens from spring to autumn, depending on your orchid and on your season. You might know that when the flowers are done, when they fade and they fall, new leaves start to grow. That is the beginning of the vegetative growth season, and it's a very important time for the future of the orchid, health-wise and bloom-wise. So the blooming of your orchid is strictly related to its vegetative growth, but not only from the point of view of the physical location, but also from the availability of energy for multiple spikes. These spikes require quite a lot of resources from your orchid. So obviously, if your orchid doesn't have enough resources, it might simply opt to produce only one flower spike instead of two. So let's address a little bit this energy availability and how we can maximize it. One thing that I personally like to do is to completely cut off the existing flower spikes after the initial inflorescence is over. So when the flowers start to dry and drop, I like to cut the flower spikes from the base. And this is something many of you might know if you're older on my channel. I will make a little disclaimer. This is something that I believe helps my orchid. It's not something that everybody believes. You will find growers with very different opinions on this subject, but since this is what I do, this is what I will provide as a tip if you're looking to get at least the same results that I do. My reasoning for removing the flower spikes and pretty much eliminating any chance of them ever trying to produce secondary branches is that I believe I'm giving more energy for the orchid. Every structure you see on the orchid not only helps the orchid, but also consumes energy. It constantly needs to be maintained because it is alive. Orchids do regenerate periodically, they create new leaves periodically, and in this way they do get rid of the older structures, which might not be as functional as newer structures due to, well, wear and tear, as it were. And this is an orchid's way of conserving her energy because these structures actually give a lot in return. Leaves photosynthesize, roots absorb water and nutrients, so not only do they take energy, but they do actually produce something in return. Now, flower spikes do not do that. Yes, they're green, they have chlorophyll, maybe they can photosynthesize a little bit, but they are not nearly as efficient at it as leaves are. The flower spike's only mission is to help propagate the orchid. And propagation is not something we are necessarily interested in. So for most of us, what flower spikes do is just take resources without actually giving much in return. As long as they're green and alive, they consume resources and they don't necessarily give anything in return. So by removing them, I'm trying to remove an energy drainage source, which in my book doesn't really justify its existence since propagation is not something I'm interested in. Energy drainage from the flower spikes can actually be seen in some cases, particularly if orchids are stressed. You might note that orchids which have flowers, or even worse, a keiki growing on the flower spike, do seem to struggle a lot in their road to recovery from, let's say, root loss or things of the sort. So in those cases, we do cut the flower spike in order to conserve energy that can be put into vital organs. It's the same story with healthy orchids as well. Of course, they are not in danger of actually getting dehydrated or becoming sick. If your orchid is super healthy, flower spikes left on the orchid will not drain anything to such an extent that you'll have issues with the orchid, but I do believe that when it comes to blooming, it helps. I do like to have double spikes on my orchids as much as possible, and one way in which I try to conserve energy that can be put in those spikes is by cutting the old spikes. But again, not everybody does that, and it doesn't mean that if you don't cut the flower spikes, you will not get a double spike next year. Orchids are actually unpredictable, but I do have quite a few Phalaenopsis. I actually counted them, more than 70 Phalaenopsis, and throughout the years, I made a few statistics. And it just appears to me that orchids which do get their flower spikes cut are more prone to having better blooms or better displays or multiple flower spikes. That's why I cut them. Maya agrees. Yeah, honey, okay, I'm trying to film. Thank you. Also, as a side note, the secondary spikes which might come from these spikes never look super, super showy as the initial flower spike. So even though, yes, I'm losing out on the secondary spikes, most of the times, it's not really that impressive anyway. I feel bad for interrupting her song, so Maya will actually take part in the next scene. Now, speaking about leaving the older flower spikes on the orchid, here is what can actually happen. You can have the flower spike be green all summer long, and then as autumn comes and new flower spikes are starting to be produced, the older flower spikes start to dry out. So what did we actually achieve with leaving the older flower spikes on? Nothing. And these are two orchids that I kept with their old flower spikes. Just to make an experiment, I wanted to see if the new flush of blooms will be as impressive if I leave on the flower spike, and see what happens with the secondary spikes as well. As it turns out, my experiment will not happen because the flower spikes decided to dry out. And coincidentally, these orchids are now producing double spikes. They're actually growing singular spikes. Here we go. This is a coincidence, but as I was saying, in all of these years and with all of my orchids, this happens quite a bit, more often than you would imagine actually. So rather than having that flower spike drain energy all summer long, even if it's a little bit of energy, and having it dry out in the autumn, I just rather cut it in the spring when the flush of blooms is over, when new growth starts. That is when I remove the older flower spikes and wait for the next blooming season, and I'm personally happy with the results that I get. Now here comes that proper care bit that I mentioned in the beginning. In order to accumulate as much energy as possible in the growing season, we need to make sure that we do provide all the requirements these orchids need, and a little extra actually. Phalaenopsis orchids can grow very, very well in quite shady situations. They can grow well without much fertilizer, and they sometimes do well even with neglect. However, I do believe that this reflects in the quality of blooms and also the number of flower spikes. So during the growing season, not only do I provide the cultural needs, but I make sure not to actually skip on fertilizer or offer too little light. I discovered that these are the two most important aspects of their culture, which directly influence blooms. In very low light conditions, the orchid itself might look gorgeous. The leaves will be big, glossy, green, but when it comes to flowers, that might lack altogether, or the flower spike will just be very weak with only a few flowers. So I do like to provide quite bright light for my Phalaenopsis. Not direct sunshine, they really don't need that. But if I have a location that doesn't really receive as much natural light as I would like, I do provide artificial light. And that makes a world of difference. You don't necessarily need artificial light if you have quite a bright location in your home, but don't think that just because they don't necessarily need bright light, that the bright light will not help. It will, and I believe it will reflect on the quality of blooming you will have. Also fertilizer. These orchids can actually grow for a year or two without any type of fertilizer, only relying on their resources or the little calcium and magnesium you might have in your tap water, combined with a little nitrogen from the composition of medium. They find a few things, even if you don't supplement fertilizer separately. But at some point, the orchid will start to have some deficiencies. And if they're not visible necessarily on the leaves, you'll see them in their rhythm of growth. They will start to grow slower, they might not produce very big leaves, they will start to produce smaller leaves, and also the quantity of flower spikes will diminish. Not only that, but also the flowers themselves might suffer. So even if the orchid still survives, a lack of fertilizing will add up over time, and you will see it slowly but surely in the way it grows and in the way it blooms. So I do provide quite a lot of fertilization for these orchids. I do believe they're heavy feeders generally, and in my experience, this has led to proper growth and also proper flowering. And lastly, provide a stress-free life. Stress takes a lot of energy and resources from an orchid. So if your orchid has recently been through loss of roots, loss of leaves, maybe a pest attack even, maybe it wasn't cared for properly, didn't get enough light, enough fertilizer, and so on and so forth, then chances for a showy flower display or multiple flower spikes decrease. Again, it's not a rule set in stone. Some orchids, depending on their parentage, are prone to multiple flower spikes, and I will show you the exceptions at the end of the video. But statistically speaking, if you have an orchid which you know has been through some sort of stress, then chances for double spikes are pretty diminished. This is one that I acquired last year. It was the one that had a keiki and no roots, if you remember. And well, it's just now that it started to produce a little flower spike, only one. I'm not expecting two of them, but all of these orchids which are stressed... She forgot the lyrics. So all of these orchids which are stressed or have never created double spikes for you, they can actually create double spikes in the future if all of these energy draining things just disappear. So just because your orchid never created double spikes, it doesn't mean it cannot. Maybe it just has to do with the culture and all of these things that we talked about. There is a chance that the orchid will just never make double spikes or multiple spikes, but let's not be negative, and first let's try to resolve the culture issues. Alrighty, now for the exceptions to the things that I was telling you about. There are orchids which are simply genetically prone to producing multiple flower spikes. One of them is the Phalaenopsis mini mark, which for me has always created more than two flower spikes, or at least two flower spikes. This year I seem to have three of them, but my orchid is slightly stressed. So even under conditions of stress, this orchid still produces flower spikes. That is its genetic heritage. It's not something I do necessarily. But with this orchid, the flower spikes tend to be kind of tiny, kind of flimsy. We cannot compare it to a big cascading orchid such as the big white Phalaenopsis that you see in flower shops. She creates tinier flower spikes, so the energy necessary for blooming is not the same as with other orchids. And here is an example of an orchid which seems to produce a flower spike further up between the first and second leaf. Although I told you the general rule is that the flower spikes will be created between the second and the third leaf. Well, if you take a much closer look at the orchid, you might be able to see that the flower spike actually sprouts from here. And you can tell by the way the stem is just bulging here. This flower spike simply did not manage to pierce through the leaf here, and it managed to come out from this location. It does not mean that it took away this space. This location can produce another flower spike in future years. And sometimes this anomaly can be even more visible. Sometimes we can see that the flower spike does sprout from this location, and we can see it starting to pierce through the leaf. But as it grows, it decides to just move onwards and sprout from a further up location. Again, this doesn't mean that this location is taken. It just means that a little anomaly happened here and the flower spike took a little bit of a shortcut. And one more idea before we end the video. Phalaenopsis orchids do need that drop in temperature in the autumn or the beginning of winter to start initiating flower spikes. Whether it's 1, 2, 3 or more flower spikes, they all need this drop in temperature. It is what tells them that summertime is over, vegetative growth should stop, and flowering should start. Many people like to refer to this as stress, but the drop in temperature is not nearly low enough to cause any stress to the orchid, and I tend to stay away from calling it as such because it opens the gate for some sort of interpretation in which stressing orchids actually leads to blooming, which is absolutely totally wrong and it should never be done in my opinion. So, dropping temperature only means that we're letting them know that summer is over, it's time to bloom, time to stop growing your leaves and start thinking about some flowers. It is not stressed. We are not lowering the temperature that much to cause any stress. And with that said, I want to wish you all a happy new year once again. Hope you have a wonderful year. I hope that my voice will not get worse because I really need to start uploading again, right, Maya? I've been slacking these past few weeks. But I will do my best. Regular schedule starts today. And with that said, you know the drill. Like or dislike this video below. Subscribe for regular orchid videos, tutorials, experiments, and all sorts of discussions such as today. You want, oh, I know what you want. She wants carrot. Whenever I do my nails red or orange or one of these colors, she wants to eat them. I'll bring you some carrot, don't worry. So if you wish to support the channel and the carrot provision of the ladies, do consider visiting the merch store down below. And with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!